Hello, I'm Andy Fell. We spend most of our time inside buildings, but until recently we haven't paid a lot of attention to the quality of air we breathe indoors. That's beginning to change, and to talk about that, we have three UC Davis experts. Rich Corsi, Dean of the College of Engineering, Chris Cappa, Professor and Chair of Civil and Environmental Engineering, and Theresa Pistochini, Engineering Manager at the Western Cooling Efficiency Centre. Rich, you've been in this field for a long time. What's new in indoor air quality?
I think what's new over the last couple of years is this tremendous increase in public awareness of the importance of indoor air quality, driven by the pandemic, driven by wildfires, an acknowledgement of the importance that's getting beyond the general public, even to funding agencies. We've never had much money to do research on indoor air quality, and suddenly there's money being appropriated to better understand and improve indoor air quality, especially in public spaces.
And this is a little strange, right? Because when you think about it, we do spend most of our time indoors, but we don't think very much about the air indoors, more about what's outside.
Yeah, I mean, the average American lives to be about 79 years old. We spend almost 70 of those 79 years inside of buildings, and most of the air pollution that we inhale during our lifetimes is pollution that we inhale indoors, and that includes pollution of outdoor origin, like wildfire smoke and smog and those types of things.
So we have outdoor air pollution like smog and wildfire smoke, but you can also have sources of air pollution from indoors. So what, Chris, maybe what are some things that pollute the air indoors?
There's lots of different indoor sources. One is obviously the air that we exhale. That's going to be the source of things like COVID-19 and the flu and other respiratory diseases. But there's also everyday activities like cooking, vacuuming. Those are all sources of indoor pollution. And then all sorts of just materials inside our homes, like sometimes our couches, our furniture in different ways are going to give off different types of gases that aren't necessarily very good for us. So there's lots of different indoor sources.
So what are the things, when you're thinking about indoor air quality and how to manage it, what are some of the things you have to take into consideration?
I think one thing we need to consider first is the building type. So homes are very different than other types of commercial buildings. Homes are unique in that there is a lot of perimeter area for the amount of space in the home. So we need a lot of both heating and cooling to condition our homes. And generally, the occupant density is low. Our homes are not generally crowded with a lot of people. And so generally, homes don't bring in any outside ventilation on purpose. We rely on doors and windows. In commercial buildings, sometimes we have, multi-story office buildings. In those cases, we have a lot of interior volume, not a lot of surface area, and our buildings are cooling driven, meaning we need a lot of cooling for commercial buildings. In these cases, too, because of the occupant density, we bring in ventilation air on purpose to make sure that we are ventilating those buildings appropriately. So there's a lot of differences in building design we have to consider when we're thinking about how to optimally improve indoor air quality.
Can you?
Which is to say, I think one of the biggest ways in which we try to address indoor air quality is really just replacing the indoor air with outdoor air, bringing in outside air and exchanging it and sending the inside air outside. And so we can think about actively trying to do that with our HVAC systems. We could think about just hoping that opening the windows does it as well, or having a fan in the windows. But that exchange is one of the primary ways that we try to clean up the air inside. Of course, that's really challenging when the air outside isn't very good, like when we have wildfire smoke or if you live in a particularly polluted city or part of a city.
And we can supplement that with control devices in buildings, filtration systems that can, at least with respect to particulate matter, supplement ventilation and oftentimes remove more particles in indoor environments than even ventilation can in many cases.
If you recall in the pandemic, as an immediate response, one of the recommendations from various health-related agencies was to bring in as much outdoor air ventilation into buildings as possible. And that was a short-term response measure. In theory, that does reduce the risk of infectious disease spread, but we can't do that sustainably forever because it requires heating and cooling to make that air comfortable, and it also exposes us to excess amounts of outdoor air pollution.
Yeah, and at UC Davis, we also pretty quickly ran into the challenge of thinking about trying to bring in as much outside air as we could, and then we had a bunch of wildfire smoke. And so then we wanted to shut down all the outside air. And so trying to find that balance is a real challenge right now.
Yeah, I would also say California is different than the rest of the country, much of the rest of the country. Right? During the pandemic, there was a lot of interest in opening windows in schools, getting kids back in school. There are a lot of schools across this country, probably a majority of them now, that have inoperable windows. You can't open windows. You can't bring in more ventilation by opening windows. I heard from some school districts that they didn't want to leave windows open because of crime in the area. And so you have these equity issues as well that are spread across all of the things we're talking about.
And then you have the people that are actually operating the buildings, the facility managers and the maintenance staff, and they're hearing, open all the outside air intakes, and then the fire comes and they're hearing, close all the outside air intakes. Mm. And at the end of the day, we really need to develop automated engineering solutions that are scalable and cost-effective that essentially can handle these outdoor air decisions without any kind of manual intervention based on what's happening outdoors and what's happening indoors. Mm. So that's one of our goals.
And now you've done quite a bit of work with schools in California on their air quality issues.
I think schools are a first priority when thinking about how to improve indoor air quality. There's some things that are unique about schools. One, we have this really high occupant density. So students are generating a lot of these respiratory aerosols. The other thing that's interesting about schools is they tend to be, the systems tend to be fairly repeatable between schools, meaning the same type of
kind of a standard system.
Yeah, sorry, that's the
school.
Word I'm looking for, standard. HVAC systems tend to be pretty standard between classrooms. So if we can develop sustainable solutions, it could be quite scalable. Schools also tend to be under-resourced from a facilities perspective. They often don't have engineering staff, and so coming up with simple, cost-effective solutions is really important. The other thing is that there's been a lot of research that shows that when students have better ventilation, more outside air in their classrooms, they perform better academically and the absence rates are lower. So there's a real economic incentive to improve ventilation in schools. And so in my mind, that's a really good place to focus on improvements.
Yeah, well, I would add, you know, it's hard to think of another place where more Americans spend time every day. 1 in 5 Americans spend some time in a school every single day. There are many places we can say where 1 in 5 Americans spend time in that type of an environment. So it makes schools additionally important for that reason. I've done a lot of research in schools in Texas, which is much different than California in climate. Mm-hmm. Hundreds of classrooms from high school down to kindergarten, and we find in almost 100% of the cases, the air exchange rate with the outdoor environment is about 1/2 of what we would normally design according to standards. And that's a recipe for kids getting sick in flu season and kids getting sick with COVID, et cetera.
Wow.
The rebreathe fraction of air in those classrooms, in many of those classrooms, was as high as 5%, which means every time you inhale air, you're in about 5% of the air you inhale came out of the lungs of other students in the classroom.
That's a lovely thought.
It's a bad situation when you're under ventilating that much.
So I guess for a long time we've tended to design HVAC systems for energy efficiency, right? Especially in California. Is that working at cross purposes with air quality when we try and save energy?
It certainly can be, right? It's going to quite often. One of the strategies is to just reduce the amount of outside air that you're bringing in. But that's going to really be driven by your heating and cooling needs in different ways. So it certainly can be at cross purposes.
Generally, the approach has been to set minimum ventilation standards for a minimum air quality perspective and then focus on reducing energy as much as possible. So, for example, one of the things that's happened nationwide is newer building code has required tighter building envelopes. So every time a building is constructed, there's leakage standards for those buildings. And as we tighten the envelopes, the amount of air exchange between outside and inside that happens naturally without mechanical ventilation is reduced. Mm-hmm. And so it's actually when mechanical ventilation systems don't work right or they fail, it's the people in the newer buildings that are actually most at risk. And so oftentimes, you know, in the pandemic, I would have people tell me, well, I work in a new building, so I'm more confident that I'm safe. And I was like, well, you know, if you're in a leaky building, an old leaky building, you're kind of half outside anyway, right? And so there's that's one of the just one of the considerations as we've tightened the energy codes, we make our buildings tighter, which is the right strategy, right? Like that is the way to do things, because as we tighten our buildings and we rely on mechanical ventilation, we can then filter that ventilation and improve health. Okay. But we have to make sure that systems are working correctly and working as designed. And that's where sensing comes in really handy. So becoming much more common, particularly in schools, are carbon dioxide sensors. And so as students are breathing, the carbon dioxide concentration in the room rises. And if we're ventilating appropriately, that value should stay under about 1,100 parts per million. And so carbon dioxide sensors can serve essentially as an alert or warning system that, and it's not an emergency. A high CO2 level isn't an emergency, but essentially it's a way for us to know, a way for facility managers to know that there's a problem that needs to be investigated.
And tell you that there's too much rebreathing going on, as you put it.
Not enough dilution. Not diluting yeah. what people are exhaling with outside air.
Yeah. The flip side of what Theresa said is that for wildfires, having a tighter building envelope is not a bad thing, especially if you can control the air intake and you can filter it. So there's a conflict there between infectious disease transmission, airborne infectious disease transmission, and wildfires, which is, I think, complicated all of this quite a bit. You know, increased wildfires during pandemic is a complex issue to resolve. And then you look at, again, equity issues. Families who live in older, leakier, not so expensive, newer homes tend to be exposed a lot more to whatever the pollution sources are outside, whether they're located near industrial facilities or in wildfire smoke situations. Right? So buildings are complex.
Yeah, it certainly seems you have a complex problem of a lot of different moving parts. And I think we've talked about this, one of the issues was there are so many different things you could be measuring to measure indoor air quality. You've got volatiles, you've got particulates, you've got viruses. So it's a question of how do you decide what to look at?
Yeah, some of that's going to be just driven by what technology is available at a given time. So it's currently pretty easy to measure carbon dioxide. Mm-hmm. It's pretty easy to measure particulate matter, or at least some measure of particulate matter. It's much harder to measure some of those volatiles, especially if you want to measure them one compound at a time, which can be very important because different volatiles will have different impacts on people or different health effects. It's currently very challenging to measure viruses or bacteria in the air, right? So we're limited in part by what we're able to measure easy, right? Unless you want to have every room that you're in being a dedicated study, you know, a research study. So if you want to expand these things, you have to think about what's available. So right now, as Theresa mentioned, there's a lot more efforts to measure carbon dioxide in places like classrooms and elsewhere. And we're seeing more and more places that are measuring particulate matter as well. And I think in the future, we'll just see continued development of some of these tools that we'll be able to use to make better decisions about how we operate our buildings and think about the air quality.
I think improved sensing is really important because for energy, if you have an energy efficient building, if a system stops working correctly and starts consuming a lot of excess energy, you get the bill, right? At the end of the month, it's like, whoa, what happened, right? Whereas if something happens with your indoor air quality, you generally would not realize that there's a problem. And so this is what sensors can tell us, that we essentially can get that information and then be able to act on it.
There's been a bit of a sensor revolution. Sensing technologies, especially for particulate matter, has gotten less expensive, smaller, more available to the public, more accessible. There's a move right now to try to develop sensors that do a better job of talking to building occupants. So if you're cooking, and all of a sudden particle levels go out the roof, if you will, while you're cooking, that there'll be some messaging that says, turn on your vent hood.
Or have it turn on all by itself.
Yeah. Or have it turn on all by itself. So this, but you need sensors to know when you need to do that, or at least when somebody starts to cook, right? So I think sensor technologies hold a lot of promise in the future because of the lowering of the cost, the more accurate nature of them, for helping us operate buildings in such a way that they keep people safer.
It kind of blows my mind when I think about it, like the level of sensing and automation we have in our cars or our airplanes or other types of systems. And yet buildings, we still have to reach up and turn on the vent hood when we have the technology to sense that someone is cooking and turn it on and turn it off, right? And so that's the way things are moving. It's just behind other industries because historically we haven't valued that.
And making sure everybody has access to that technology, because not everybody has a functioning hood over their stove, right?
Yeah, and also some of it might mean having, you know, a networked home that has some internet connection that controls your HVAC, and I'm not sure if I want an internet company to know all that information.
I think a lot of it can be done internally as well. You don't necessarily need it pushed out to the whole
pushed
world,
out to the cloud.
To the cloud or anything like that. You can do it based on the measurements right in your home and not have to send it out anywhere.
You know, what you just said is interesting. There's been discussions in the indoor air quality field for 20, 25 years now about regulating indoor air quality. And the general public's immediate response is, I don't want anybody to know what's in my home. You're not going to come into my home and take any measurements. Of course, nobody would do that. It would be on public spaces and schools and public buildings, et cetera. But that is a first gut reaction with many people is, I don't want you measuring stuff in my house.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What are the things people can do if you're just at home and you're concerned about your quality in your home? What are things you can do to improve that?
Well, the main sources, one of the main sources in homes is cooking, right? So certainly looking at your ventilation options in home when you're cooking. So if you can, assuming air quality is good outside, opening a window when you're cooking, if you have a ventilation hood that exhausts outdoors, then using that when you're cooking. Potentially running a portable air cleaner when you're cooking, a filtration type portable air cleaner, HEPA filter, or as maybe Rich will talk about, there's do-it-yourself versions as well. So certainly cooking is a main source. Any type of, you know, think carefully about basically anything that creates a scent is a chemical, right? So thinking about cleaning products, scented products, candle burning, incense burning, all these things are emitting some type of air pollution to your indoor air. Certainly smoking indoors, not recommended. Smoking in general, not recommended. So those are some of the obvious places to start.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you guys want to chime in on that.
I would say the air cleaners, especially for particulate matter, help solve both the airborne infectious disease problem and wildfire smoke problem. So they are one technology where you don't have to worry about a trade-off there, like ventilation, right?
I think one thing to recognize with indoor air quality and indoor pollution sources is some things that create pollution are things that we intentionally do, like Teresa mentioned, candles, right? Some people like the scent of the candles and they want to do that. We should recognize that those are pollution, but those are choices in some ways that people are making. I think where that can get a little more tricky is when we're in more public spaces and there's a lot of different people who might have different sensitivities to these things. And then we have to start thinking it's not just about your choice anymore. It's about the choice of everybody in those spaces and their exposure to what might be nice to you might feel like pollution to somebody else.
So you might have your air freshener plug in at home, but you maybe wouldn't take it to the office.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, this has been a great discussion. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.